Welcome to Offline in OutSystems 10. In this session, we'd like to talk about the offline data synchronization elements. There are a number of components that have been placed inside of our OutSystems mobile apps to help us be able to do offline data synchronization more easily. So to understand that, we'll look at some of those elements and we'll see how they fit in the normal sequence of an offline data synchronization. So typically we have to begin a data synchronization either automatically or through some trigger on the client, and then that client would have to look at its offline or local storage data and gather some of that information and call the server. The server could then either look at that data or find the new information that's on the server and return whatever it thinks the latest correct set of information is back to the client. And then the client would go ahead and update the local data from the information that it got back from the server. So we're going to look at the elements and how they fit in with this path by going through a simple synchronization path example. So when we think about offline interactions, we mentioned that they would use local storage. So we can have things happening on the device. The device may need to retrieve or update and store lots of information, and it can do that inside of local storage. But at some point, we want it to be able to synchronize with the server. And when it needs to synchronize with the server, that could either be kicked off automatically, or we could choose a way to go ahead and trigger that. But when that occurs, certain sets of information from local storage would be sent back to the server, and then the server would look at any new information it might have and send that back. So there'd be a set of steps that might occur in between receiving the call and the data, deciding what else to do, and then sending some information back. So this is one of those processes where, depending on your business and your logic, this will be very specific to your app and to the way you wish to approach it. So because, you know, we're not putting any information here about the logic because it would be very specific. We have one set of answers for the to-do application, but there may be a very different set of answers for other types of applications. So let's look at the types of information and the types of elements that are available to help us do this inside of OutSystems 10. So if we go to the logic tab, what we can see is that there are a number of offline data sync client actions. And these client actions are the offline data sync action, the offline data sync configuration action, the trigger offline data sync, and then there's also a server action called ServerDataSync. So we're going to look at each one of these and see how it might fit into the steps that we mentioned earlier. So along with those actions, there's also a block that is in the common UI elements, and that block has some things incorporated into it, and those are mostly events. So it's called the offline data sync events block, and we can see it here from the common UI area, and it has these events. It knows when a synchronization has started, when a synchronization has completed, when we might have an error. It has the capability with these client actions to trigger all of those, and it can also trigger a synchronization or trigger a configuration. So this block can do a lot of different things and receive different types of events. So this block would be very useful for us to use in different types of pages if we wanted to be able to react to different steps in the synchronization process. Now, this block also relies on a private block that is part of the Silk UI mobile patterns. So if you look at the Silk UI mobile patterns under private, there are two other things that are very important for synchronization. There is the network status changed. So there is a block from Silk UI that knows how to go ahead and detect whether or not our network status has changed. So whether we're online or offline, it can go ahead and detect that, and it can give us more information about that when it throws the event. So if a change has occurred, it can tell us, and then we can detect the change. Much like there is this common block, there is a private block for the offline data sync core, and that contains different types of events for all of the different actions that are above. So those two blocks work together to be able to detect and know all of the things that might be happening regarding synchronization, and then the network status change is keeping track of that piece. So how do these things end up getting delivered to us, and how would they be inside of some screen that we are creating? Would we have to place them there, or would we have to do any of that work? And the answer is that if you use the layout block or the layout blank block to go ahead and create your screen, so if you're using the layout or the blank layout, there's always the offline data sync events attached to the bottom of those layouts. So here you can see a container for offline data sync, and it is including that block so that we have access to those events, and those actions are available to go ahead and they're available to the screen if needed. So let's look at those synchronization actions again and see how this would play out if we go through the normal step of events. Now, before we do that, we should think about, all right, if those steps are going to occur when a synchronization occurs, when should we synchronize? So the answer of when we should synchronize may be automatically upon different types of external events, or we may want to synchronize whenever we decide to. So if it was an external event, like, hey, we just logged in, maybe we would want to synchronize the data because we just opened the app and logged in and we'd like to go ahead and get a fresh start. Maybe we were offline and we just got network connectivity and came back online, so we might have had a number of things being saved and occurred in local storage because we were offline, and we'd like to synchronize again to get things back in sync with the server now that we're online. And we may be resuming the app. We may have closed the app and decided not to use it for a little while, and then we came back and we go ahead and open the app, and when we open the app it does that. So we might need to synchronize data on any of these three events. And here I just used our process flow editor, not because this is actually a business process, it is not, but we may log into the app, and if we log into the app we may want to sync on login. And then as we're using the app, we may lose network connectivity, so when we come back online, we may want to sync when we are online. And then if we're using the app and we close it and reopen it, we may want to sync on resume and then continue using the app. So both on login, online, and on resume are different types of lifecycle events of how people use an app that we may want to be able to react to and do synchronizations with. So how would we determine, and how would we say, yes, I'd like to go ahead and sync when I'm online, logging in, or resuming? And the answer is, we looked at those actions that are available in the logic tab. So one of the actions is called offline data sync configuration. And this is what that action looks like. It's really just a bunch of assignments, and the assignments are going to be assigning whether we should sync online, on login, on resume. So each one of these is set to false by default. If we turn it to true, then it would go ahead and sync on any one of these that we happen to choose. If we try to sync, there is a question of should we retry if there's a communication error and we can't contact the server. So that by default is set to false. We could say yes, please go ahead and retry. And we also need to know what the interval in seconds would be for when that retry should occur. So these are some of our configuration options to go ahead and decide if there are going to be automatic synchronizations and how we should handle those. So we could go ahead and call this, we could modify these as part of this client action, and then we'd get the behavior that we want. So that helps us go ahead and set up the configuration. But once we have configured that, those automatic synchronizations will occur. What happens if we wish to initiate a synchronization ourselves? So maybe we're using an app and we want to go ahead and sync the data, so we have some sort of refresh button to sync the data, and we ask it to refresh and sync the data. Well, maybe it creates a client action called refresh on click that starts the synchronization. And what we could do there is, in refresh on click, all we'd have to do is drag and drop the trigger offline data sync and go ahead and use this client action to be able to do that. So what does trigger offline data sync look like if we used that inside of our on-click client action? Well, all it does is start an offline data sync, and that start offline data sync comes from that Silk UI private block, private set of blocks, and it has the capability of starting an offline data sync. So you can see the note here says this is going to start an offline data synchronization that will occur in the background, and it is going to trigger the events that we would hope. The start will already have been triggered, the complete will get triggered if it works out, and if it doesn't, we'll get an error. And all of these events are available because we are using the layout or the layout blank in our screen. So as long as we're using one of those layouts, if we go ahead and use the trigger offline data synchronization, it will go ahead and begin doing that. Now it does take two different input parameters, a sync unit and a discard pending sync unit. So if we request a synchronization, but there's already one being synchronized, so there's a sync that's already scheduled, we can tell it whether or not to discard that other synchronization and only pay attention to this one. And when we talk about synchronization units, there may be a lot of local storage data that we have, and at different times we may wish to synchronize all of it or synchronize some of it. So for this particular example, to keep things simple, we'll be thinking about synchronizing all of it, but we may have different synchronization units pending, and we could go ahead and decide whether or not we should discard those or we should go ahead and do that work. So if in our click action we ask it to start the synchronization, so we called the trigger, and the trigger is going to start the offline data synchronization, then what happens is trigger offline data sync is really going to be calling the offline data sync. So that's one of the other client actions that's part of the framework that is available to us. So in the offline data sync that gets called and gets activated, it's going to start and then call the server data sync. So this is what this particular action does by default. So above, you can see that when you come into this action, there is a note that basically says this is a template to show you how to implement one of the particular scenarios. You could go ahead and look at other synchronization patterns, but inside of our application, you can either automatically do a synchronization, or like we just discussed, we wanted to start this process by triggering it. So we can get here by doing the trigger, because the trigger calls this offline data sync, and then this offline data sync calls the server data sync. So if we continue with the next step in the example, then obviously the offline data sync is going to call the server data sync, and this is a server action. So the server data sync server action is also a template, and it has a number of things inside of it. It first checks to make sure the user has the proper registered role, and if the user is registered and has the right type of role, it will continue. It will log the fact that we're doing a synchronization, and then we can implement whatever synchronization logic we need. As we mentioned earlier, the synchronization logic will be specific to our type of data and our type of application. So we'll have to decide what's going to be synchronized, what goes back and forth, and how all of that is going to work. So this would depend on how many of the to-dos and what types of to-dos we would want to go ahead and synchronize back to the server. So server data sync would call the RESTful endpoint on the server. The server would then look at what's happening inside of server data sync, and in this case it may be updating some of the data, it may be retrieving more of the data, but all of this work that's being done on the server would fit inside that circle we just looked at and would have to be defined as part of our synchronization pattern. Now, when we talk about synchronization patterns, there are a number of different types of patterns that occur, and again, each one of these is going to be specific to the app type, but there is two different flavors of typical read-only data. So if we're synchronizing some data to the device and it's basically read-only, there's a way to do that in kind of bulk, and then there's a way to do that that is optimized, and those are those first two patterns. There's also, what if we allow the local storage to be updated? Those are read-write scenarios, and there's a simpler scenario where we say, look, whatever we send to the server is going to be correct, just go ahead and send it. And then there's another one that says, what happens if we send some data to the server and someone else had been disconnected and sent data as well, and now there's a conflict? Which one of the updates should actually occur? So these other two synchronization patterns are very interesting, and they can be a little bit more complicated. So if you go out to the notes and the documentation, these are available, and you can actually download samples of each of these patterns. So later we're going to discuss all of these synchronization patterns in a little more detail so that you can get a better feel for which ones we might need. We'll do that after we get a chance to use local storage and create our first synchronization pattern in our exercises. So, in this session we talked a little bit about the offline data synchronization elements, specifically the actions that are available, because those actions are necessary for us to be able to trigger the data synchronization, then use the client action to be able to call the server action that eventually returns to us the updated and synchronized data. So we walked through a kind of a shell of a simple example to go ahead and figure out how some of those pieces would work. So at this point, this should be a little bit nebulous because you have to see a real example to go ahead and feel more comfortable with it, but we're going to see one of those examples in our exercises.